立法會主席。
The President。
早晨，會議現在恢復。
Good morning. We now resume. We'll continue with the second reading debate on the Stamp Duty Amendment Bill 2012. Does any member wish to speak?
咁如果冇咧
？If not, then I'll invite the secretary to reply. The debate will come to a close after the secretary has replied. Thank you. Secretary, President, first of all, allow me to once again thank the chairman of the Bills Committee, Ms. Starry Lee, and all members of the Bills Committee and the staff of the Secretariat for their hard work in the past months. So the scrutiny of the bill has been completed, and we're now able to resume second reading. I've heard the views of many members on the second reading of the bill, and also I understand that members have given also a lot of views during the adjournment of a debate. And then concerning the low interest, and also tight supply of housing, there has been irrational exuberance in the market in recent years, and the market seems to expect prices only to go up. In just 10 months from the January to October 2012, prices have gone up by 24% or 100% compared to the low level in 2008. If prices continue to deviate from economic fundamentals, there will be further risk of a bubble developing, and that would impact on the macroeconomy and the stability of the financial system. To tackle this extraordinary situation, on the 26th of October 2012, the administration announced that there would be an enhanced special stamp duty and the BSD will be introduced. This would be an extraordinary measure to tackle exceptional times. This is a measure to tackle short-term speculation and to cool down the market. And also, when supply is still tight, we would give priority to the housing needs or home purchase needs of Hong Kong PR. The 2012 Stamp Duty Amendment Bill is to implement the demand control measures mentioned above. The fact is that after the rolling out of a series of demand suppression measures, including what was announced on the 22nd of February 2013, meaning doubling the ad valorem stamp duty, we have successfully stabilized prices and we have changed the expectations of the market that prices would only go up because that is irrational. From March 2013 to January this year, prices have remained more or less stable, and the increase has narrowed to a monthly average of 0.2% compared to the monthly average of 2.7% from January to February last month. This is a much lower increase. And with regard to small units which had experienced larger property prices increase, the entire year of 2013 has seen an increase which is 20% lower than that for 2012. In terms of rental, in 2013, the overall increase was 3.4%, which is a much lower increase than that in 2012. Also, non-local individual or company buyers, and company buyers, I mean both local and non-local company buyers, the number of properties bought by them has dropped to a monthly average of 239 cases in 2013, or 5% of overall transactions, which is much lower than the monthly average of 1,089 cases from January to October 2012. In other words, before we had the BSD. That number accounted for 13.6% of overall transactions. So you could see that our measures were effective in giving priority to the home purchase needs of Hong Kong PR. It is correct that our measures have yielded initial success. However, the market is still uncertain. We have to make sure that demand control measures would continuously effectively tackle the market situation so our property market can develop healthily and in a stable manner. This is not the time to withdraw those measures. There are views saying that these demand suppression measures intervene into the market and Hong Kong's status as a free market is dealt a blow. We believe that is too generalized. To be practical, if the administration faces irrational exuberance in the property market and we do not do anything, now what would be the consequence? We can imagine a property bubble developing in an environment where there is ultra-low interest and where there is QE in some developed economies allowing capital to flow around. And we can see the bubble getting more serious. Recently, in a research paper by the International Settlement Bank, it is said that amongst all property market stabilizing measures, amending the property tax would be one of the property tools that would yield remarkable results. In Hong Kong, we have got the BSD. These are demand control measures, and they belong to this type of policy tools. In fact, some other countries and areas, including those that practice market economy, have taken demand suppression measures according to their actual situations. Hong Kong is a small and external-oriented economic entity. When we have economic globalization, there is indeed a need for us to take defensive measures. President, I must emphasize that our achievement in a free economy is premised on a series of institutional and policy factors, including protection for private property, market freedom, and free flow of information and capital. Some famous international think tanks like Heritage Foundation and Cato Institute have continued to rank Hong Kong as the most or the freest market economy in the world. The administration will continue to abide by the principle of a free market, and we will increase demand so as to tackle the problem of housing at its root. When there is balanced supply and demand, we would consider lowering or even cancelling the relevant demand suppression measures. Over the past year or so, during the scrutiny of the bill, the administration has listened to the views of the Bills Committee and also relevant stakeholders. The Bills Committee has also made many valuable views. Our stance has always been that without going against the policy of suppressing demand and also the legislative intent of the bill, and also that the bill will not be affected in terms of its effectiveness and operational efficiency, we will do our best to take up the views of members and stakeholders. We have moved amendments to the bill according to the views collected, including the following four. Number one, according to views of the industry and the Bills Committee, we propose to relax the mechanism for refunding BSD for redevelopment programs so that we would implement the policy objective of not having the BSD suppress redevelopment. Compared to the original mechanism, the relaxed mechanism would allow the refund of BSD to take place about 4 or 5 years earlier. Secondly, the Bills Committee was worried that under the bill, Hong Kong PR minors could go through their trustees or guardians to buy residential property and therefore be exempted from BSD. They are afraid that this could be abused, especially when the trustee or the guardian, including their parents, are non-Hong Kong PRs. This will affect the effectiveness of the BSD. Mrs. Regina Ip originally proposed an amendment to this point in order to cancel the relevant exemption. Considering that minors usually have to be taken care of by parents or guardians and therefore live with them, so their housing need would not be prejudiced per se if the exemption is cancelled. And also the member's proposal would help to tighten up the exemption of the BSD so the BSD can better achieve its original policy intent of giving priority to Hong Kong PR's housing needs. The administration is of the view that Mrs. Ip's proposal is acceptable in terms of law and also policy, so we decided to adopt it and the administration will be moving the relevant amendment. Number 3, Section 15 of the Stamp Duty Ordinance stipulates that documents which have not been properly stamped should not be accepted as evidence in certain legal procedures. To respond to the concern of the Law Society and the Hong Kong Association of Banks, they say that if the buyer has not paid the buyer stamp duty, it should not affect the innocent party, for example, the selling party, and their rights to submit the relevant documents in a legal procedure. Therefore, the administration is moving an amendment to allow documents or instruments that have not been stamped for BSD. If these are not submitted by the buyers, then they should be admitted as evidence by the court in a civil proceeding. Number 4, non-Hong Kong PRs may be forced to sell their property not because of their own intention. For example, the property is resumed by the URA or that the property is resumed under the Land Resumption Ordinance by the government. To take care of the needs of these people, we propose in the bill that non-Hong Kong PR owners affected under these situations, when they buy alternative replacement property, they should be exempted from paying the BSD. After considering the views collected, we propose that the relevant exemption should be extended to similar compulsory resumption under other ordinances. And these relevant ordinances are Mass Transit Land Resumption and Related Provisions Ordinance, ROSE, Bracket Works Use and Compensation Ordinance, and Land Resumption Possessory Title Ordinance. Also, the administration will be making other minor and technical amendments to the bill so the relevant provisions are clearer. These include amendments proposed by the legal advisor of the Bills Committee. The relevant amendments will not make any material change to the contents of the bill. Mr. President, apart from amendments of the administration, some members have proposed amendments to different issues. As I said earlier, the administration has already carefully studied members' views. If their views are the same as ours, and if they do not affect the effectiveness of the measures, the administration will do our best to adopt them. However, there are amendments which do not go against the legislation to suppress demand in principle. However, they may detract from the force or strength of these measures, or they sometimes go against the policy intent, or that there will be impact done to the other aspects of the bill. So the administration could not support these amendments. Mr. James Toh mentioned that any amendment to the SSD and BSD, any amendment to the tax rate, now that must be submitted by the FS in the form of a subsidiary legislation, and there must be the procedure of positive vetting, or that the Legislative Council should be able to amend it by way of a resolution. The administration thinks this is undesirable. I believe we all understand that the property market is very sensitive to external factors and any change in those. If the global economic situation and interest rates should be changed, the property market may adjust very quickly and it may go in the opposite direction. During the bill scrutiny period, quite some members and also stakeholders in the financial and other related industries have said that the administration must ensure that the demand control measures can be timely adjusted, and they emphasize that they must be timely adjusted according to the market situation, or even administration should cancel or withdraw those measures. The bill's negative vetting approach to amend the tax rates of BSD and SSD can be done in such a way that they can come into immediate effect when the subsidiary legislation is gazetted. Then we can ensure that if there is a need in the future, we can make quick response to the market situation and to adjust the relevant measures to respond to the views of stakeholders. Mr. James Toh is proposing a positive vetting mechanism. If that is done, the administration will first have to give notice, advance notice, of a tax rate change, and then the Legislative Council has to decide whether the administration will set up a committee to scrutinize it, and after that, it will be submitted to Council for vetting and endorsement, and then it has to be gazetted before the amendment can come into effect. The process will take time, and there is actually no clear time limit. This will delay the timely adjustment to be made according to the market situation, and there will be uncertainties introduced into the market in the interim period. When the market takes a reverse trend, and if the administration will have to lower or withdraw the relevant tax rates, the uncertainties will become even more serious, and that situation will affect decisions of buyers, and the market may well go into a sluggish situation, and it will be bringing more risks to the macroeconomy and the financial system. The administration is proposing the negative vetting procedure in order to put forward subsidiary legislation. This is a time-honored existing mechanism, and this exists in different ordinances, including Section 360, bracket 3, capital A of the Companies Ordinance, where the FS is empowered to adjust the level of specific fees, and also Section 4, capital A, which of the Exchanges Special Levy Ordinance, which empowers the SFST to adjust the level of the special levy of the Stock Exchange and Mercantile Exchange. They all make use of the negative vetting procedure. In fact, making use of the negative vetting procedure to amend the relevant subsidiary legislation covering the tax rates, they still have to come before the Legislative Council. If there is a need, members can amend this subsidiary legislation, and the amendment results would of course come into effect after gazetto. As for the amendment proposed by Mr. Martin Liao, first of all, I'd like to thank Mr. Liao for supporting the administration's demand suppression measures when he spoke yesterday, that they are extraordinary measures taken to tackle exceptional times. Under the mechanism proposed by Mr. Liao, the relevant amendment to the tax rate can become effective on the day of gazetto as decided by the FS. Still, the gazetto will be expired after 6 months. If because of a division of views at LegCo or because of other reasons, the administration's resolution cannot be passed within 6 months, or even they veto the administration's resolution, then that gazetted notice will become invalid immediately, and we would have to collect underpaid tax money or refund the excessive tax collected, depending on the actual content of the gazetted notice. In that case, there will be uncertainty introduced into the market, and there will be actual difficulties caused to the operation of the industry. Under the negative vetting procedure, after gazetting the relevant adjustment, the adjustment will become effective until it is amended by the Legislative Council. It still remains effective during the interim, and there need not be a refund or a collection mechanism. So comparatively, there will be more certainty in the market. We have to understand that with regard to market-sensitive and time-critical measures, it is particularly important to adopt the negative vetting procedure. Because of these considerations, the administration cannot accept the amendments proposed by Mr. James To and Mr. Martin Liao. However, the two members' amendments emphasize that the Legislative Council should have more time in scrutinizing the relevant amendments. Last week, some members proposed to me that whether there can be differential treatment when the adjustment is upwards or downwards, and that is, only when there is a reduction or withdrawal of the SSD and BSD that we would make use of the negative vetting procedure as proposed in the bill. If there is a need to increase the rates, the administration should allow the Legislative Council to scrutinize the proposal first before the adjustment is made. Through my contact with different members, the administration has given detailed consideration and balancing different factors, and the relevant considerations have been explained by me when we debated the motion to adjourn the second reading debate. We understand that these members and their concern about the negative vetting procedure, I believe their concern is mainly about an upward adjustment of the tax rate. In order to make sure there is effectiveness in these demand suppression measures and also to strike a balance between that and members' concern, now on behalf of the SAR government, I now make a formal undertaking. We still think that under the bill, there should be the preservation of the negative vetting procedure so that in the future, when we have to adjust the rates, we can still make use of it. However, if later on there is a need to move the BSD and SSD rate upwards, the administration will not make use of the negative vetting procedure as provided for in the bill. We will not use that to increase the tax rate. Rather, it's just like the amendment bill this time around. We are going to do it by way of a bill in order to amend the stamp duty ordinance in order to implement the relevant proposal. Then the Legislative Council will be able to set up a bills committee and also to make use of the process of the three readings in order to process and scrutinize the tax increase proposal by the administration. And also, only when there is a need to reduce or withdraw the relevant taxes, that we would make use of the negative vetting measures as provided for in the bill. I hope members will understand that we are making this well-intentioned undertaking with the objective of appropriately responding to members' concern of more time for scrutiny. This is also the rationale behind the proposed amendments of Mr. James To and Mr. Martin Liao. This is a formal undertaking, a solemn undertaking of the administration. Mr. President, Mr. Andrew Leung and Mr. Tommy Cheung separately proposed amendments to introduce a sunset clause so that the BSD and the SSD will cease to be effective at a designated date. The administration reiterated time and again that we cannot possibly guess the market changes and other external factors so that we can arbitrarily specify any date to stipulate that the demand suppression measures will not be effective after that. Any such rigid and groundless sunset clause will only send wrong messages to the market and stimulate demand and therefore affect the effectiveness of the measures. We'll continue to watch the market closely and we would make reference to a series of indicators including property prices, affordability by the public, transaction volume, supply of residential property, the mortgage repayment ratio, and also changes in the local and external environments, and also measures taken in response to market situations in other countries, and also the pace of tapering in Europe and in America. And then we would adjust the relevant measures when the market situation becomes balanced. Now, of course, all these cannot possibly be quantified. I also made a promise to the Bills Committee that we would give an account to the Legislative Council about a review of the measures after the bill has been passed for 1 year. Some members also say we should expand the exemption for BSD. Say, for example, Mr. Abraham Shek and Mr. Tommy Chang have separately proposed that there should be a refund or exemption mechanism for Hong Kong PR companies. We explained many times that the relevant proposal might encourage non-Hong Kong PR buyers buying property in the name of Hong Kong PR companies so they can enjoy the exemption. This will stimulate an immediate demand for residential property, and that goes against the original intent of the BSD. In Hong Kong, it is very easy to set up companies and buy company shares, and there are different ways to transfer company shares. If we exempt so-called Hong Kong PR companies from paying BSD, then people outside Hong Kong can very easily make use of different methods that cannot be easily discovered or easily tracked in order to get beneficial interest and effective ownership of company shares so that they can own the residential property under the name of that company and avoid paying BSD. This loophole can hardly be plugged, and it would detract very much from the effectiveness of the BSD, so we cannot accept the relevant proposal. Plus, under the present Hong Kong companies system, there is no distinction between companies set up by Hong Kong PRs and non-Hong Kong PRs. If we make that policy differentiation, it would introduce fundamental changes to our companies system, and people will doubt whether Hong Kong can still maintain the principle of parity treatment to all registered companies. We have also given detailed consideration to Mr. James Toh's proposal to give overall exemption to charities buying residential properties. But with the present tight demand situation, we must carefully consider the priorities for allowing different people to buy residential property. As you know, charities can have free transaction activities, including investing in residential property. If there will be comprehensive exemption for them to pay BSD, then there may be a stimulation of their demand for residential property, and that is not the same as the objective of the BSD. All along, charities are just like other people. When they buy residential property, they have to pay ad valorem stamp duty, and only with the approval of the Commissioner for Inland Revenue under Section 88 of the Inland Revenue Ordinance that they can be exempted from certain taxes, including profits tax under the IRO. And this is not the same as the stamp duty. Mr. Toh's amendment does not have any proposal to include exemption only for charities which buy these properties for charitable purposes. And if this is allowed, it will be another way to avoid the BSD, and again, it would make it not effective. Actually, the bill already proposes that residential properties given as a gift to charities will be exempted from paying BSD. We believe the bill has already balanced the policy intent of the BSD and also the needs of charities. Mr. To also proposes to tighten the exemption for the mentally incapacitated. We believe these people have a greater need than minors to buy residential property. Under the bill, we say that the guardians or trustees would have to provide written evidence, including a guardianship order or entrustment, which are effective and also legally binding. This will prove that they have the legal right to act on behalf of mentally incapacitated persons. Therefore, we don't think we should tighten the exemption. We cannot agree to Mr. Dennis Kwok's amendment either, and that is to delay the coming into effect of the relevant proposal to remove the exemption for minors. We believe this is not the same as our original intent to plug the loophole. Mr. Kenneth Leung proposes to introduce the domicile concept for BSD. If that's the case, then some people who would be exempted under the government's proposal and who are Hong Kong PRs might have to pay BSD. The administration is already moving a proposal to remove the exemption for paying BSD by Hong Kong PR minors. We believe it is not appropriate for us to accept Mr. Leung's amendment. In fact, the different tax systems enforced by the IRD do not make use of the domicile concept. I will explain all these in more detail in the CSA stage. I so speak, Mr. President, and urge members to support the second reading of the 2012 Stamp Duty Amendment Ordinance, a bill. This is also the mainstream expectation of our society. And also, members, please support and pass all the amendments to be proposed by the administration to ensure that the relevant demand suppression measures will be able to stabilize the property market. Thank you.
I now put the question to you, and that is the Stamp Duty Amendment Bill 2012 be read the second time. I now put the question to you as stated. Those in favor, please raise their hands. Those against? Mr. James Toh would like to claim a division. The bell will ring for 5 minutes.
開始表決。
Voting begins. Members, please check your votes. If there are no queries, voting is closed. The results are displayed. Number of members present, 47, 37 for, 4 against, 5 abstentions. The question is agreed by majority of the members present. I declare the motion passed. Stamp Duty Amendment Bill 2012. Committee